Ikaw, Star, paano mo malalaman kung siya na?
Kung darating siya, malalaman ko.
Paano?
Signs.
Signs?
O sige, ganito. Anong favorite number mo, Star?
3.
Okay. Yung pangatlong lalaking dadaan siya, siya na ang the one for you.
Sige nga.
1.
Wait,
ang
Grace, ha?
Uyan
ako
na,
Jones!
Eh, si Mangkyun, ha? Di ba, classmate mo yun sa chemistry class?
Si Mark ba yun? Siya na pa talaga?
Okay, Universe. Pagpupunta din siya ng Jollibee, siya na nga for me.
Hi.
Saan ka?
Magja-Jollibee. Ikaw?
Dun din.
Tara.
Hi, Mark.
Hi.
Hmm? I bought spaghetti for the both of us.
Stacy, si Star nga pala. Classmate ko. Star, si Stacy. Girlfriend ko.
Oh, you're Star. Nice to meet you.
Ito.
Jones?
Para di malata ang nagdurugo mong puso. Alam mo, nakaka-relaxin yung nangain mo eh.
Ha?
Kasi nga, spa, Ketty. Tawa na.
Corny ba?
I've been waiting for so long.
So it's you, where were you all along?
Very special moments, this will always be with me. We are here, you and I.
Pagpupunta din siya ng Jollibee, siya na nga for me.
Organizations are comprised of employees who have the ability to keep the company successfully moving forward. However, the value of employees is based on the level of their job performance. This performance depends on the effort these employees put into their work, their ability, and employer support. Effort, in part, is determined by motivation, a topic that's worthy of consideration. Motivation is the desire that exists within a person that causes that individual to act. People usually act for a number of reasons, but they are often tied to goals that have been set by themselves or others around them. Thus, motivation is a goal-directed drive, and the process seldom occurs in a void. Approaches to understanding motivation vary because many theorists have developed their own views and models. Some approaches focus on intrinsic motivators that are inside an individual, while others concentrate on extrinsic factors that enhance motivation externally. Each approach has contributed to an understanding of human motivation. So let's examine four approaches to understanding motivation. The theory of human motivation developed by Abraham Maslow has received a great deal of attention in academic and practitioner settings. This need theory of motivation assumes only unsatisfied needs motivate individuals. Maslow classified human needs into five categories that ascend in definite order. Until the more basic needs are adequately met, a person will not fully strive to meet higher needs. Maslow's well-known hierarchy of needs is comprised of physiological needs, safety and security needs, belongingness and love needs, esteem needs, and self-actualization needs. Frederick Herzberg's motivation hygiene theory assumes that one group of factors, motivators, accounts for increases in individual motivation because of enrichment and other positive work characteristics. Alternatively, hygiene factors can cause employees to become dissatisfied with work if these basic expectations are not adequately addressed. However, hygiene factors do not directly motivate employees. Herzberg's motivators include achievement, recognition, work itself, responsibility, and advancement. And those hygiene factors include things like interpersonal relationships, company policy and administration, supervision, salary, and working conditions. People want to be treated fairly at work, which is the basic underlying theme embedded within equity theory. Equity is defined as the perceived fairness of what a person does compared with what the person receives for doing it. Inputs are what a person brings to the organization, including educational level, age, experience, productivity, and other skills or efforts. Outcomes received by a person are the rewards obtained in exchange for these inputs. Outcomes include pay, benefits, recognition of achievement, prestige, and other rewards received. Motivation is also influenced by what people expect. If expectations are not met, people may feel that they've been treated unfairly and consequently become dissatisfied. This theory states that individuals base decisions about their behaviors on their expectations that one or another alternate behavior is more likely to lead to desired outcomes. There are three aspects of these behavior-outcome relationships. Effort-performance expectations refer to employees' beliefs that working harder will lead to high performance. Performance reward linkage considers individuals' expectations that high performance will actually lead to rewards. And the value of rewards refers to how valuable the rewards are to the employee. There is a motivating effect associated with making successful progress in meaningful work. Some would argue that this is the most powerful basis for motivation.
Today in this video, we are going to talk about the theories of leadership. So without wasting more time, let's jump into the video. Leadership theories are schools of thought which brought forward to explain how and why certain individuals become leaders. Leadership theories emphasize the traits and behaviors that individuals can adopt to boost their own leadership abilities. Basically, we have five different leadership theories. What are they? First, great man theory. Second, trait theory. Third, contingency theory. Fourth, situational theory. And last, behavioral theory. Now, let us see all these theories in detail. Great man theory. According to the great man theory, which should perhaps be called the great person theory. According to this theory, leaders are born with just the right traits and abilities for leading. According to this theory, leaders have different skills such as they have charisma, they are intellect, they are confident, they have great communication skills and social skills. This theory suggests that the ability to lead is inherent. This theory focuses on the point that the best leaders are born, not made. The term great man was adopted at the time because leadership was reserved for males, especially in military leadership. So basically here we can conclude, great man theory is based on the beliefs that leaders are exceptional people who are born as a leader, not made. Next theory we have, trait theory. The trait theory is basically concerned with and interfering personality traits of a leader. This theory suggests that leaders differ from followers with respect to a small number of key traits, and these traits remain unchanged across time. Scholars researching the trait theory try to identify leadership characteristics from different perspectives. They focus on the psychological attributes such as appearance, weight, and height. They focus on demographics such as age, education, and family background, and intelligence. Hence, according to trait theory, people are born with certain characteristics which make them a leader. Their intelligence, level of energy and activity, their education, age, weight, height, their family background, task-relevant knowledge, and so on. Next, we have contingency theory. The contingency theory emphasizes different variables in a specific setting that determine the style of leadership which best suit in a situation. It is founded on a principle that not a single leadership style is applicable to all situations. According to famous leadership researchers, Hodgson and White, they believe that the best form of leadership is one that finds the perfect balance between behavior, needs, and context. According to them, good leaders not only possess the right qualities, but they are also able to evaluate the need of their followers and the situation at hand. In summary, we can say, the contingency theory suggests that great leadership is a combination of many key variables. According to situational theory, the situational theory is similar to contingency theory, as it also posits that not a single leadership style can be applied in all situations. As its name suggests, the theory implies that leadership depends on the situation at hand. In simple words, we can say, leaders should always correspond their leadership to their respective situation by assessing certain variables such as type of task, nature of followers, and more. Hence, this theory says a good situational leader is one who can quickly change leadership style as the situation changes. The best action of the leader depends on a range of situational factors. Next, we have behavioral theory. In behavioral theory, the focus is on the specific behaviors and actions of leaders rather than their traits or characteristics. Behavioral theory suggests that effective leadership is the result of many learned skills. According to behavioral theory, individuals need three basic skills to lead their followers. What are they? Technical skill, human skill, and conceptual skill. Here, technical skills refers to a leader's knowledge of the process or technique, whereas human skills means that one is able to interact with other individuals. While conceptual skill enable the leader to come up with ideas for running the organization or society smoothly. So here we have completed the leadership theory. Let's have a quick revision on all these leadership theories. First, we have great man theory, which say that leaders are born, not made. Second, we have trait theory, which say that there are certain characteristics which make a leader. Third, we have contingency theory, which say good leaders not only possess the right qualities, but they are also able to evaluate the need of their followers. According to situational theory, A leader should have the art to take decisions differently in different situations. They should know the art of adopting different leadership styles in different situations. Because in every situation, only one leadership style is not going to work. So in a different situation, a leader should know how to take different actions and different leadership styles. And last theory we have seen, behavioral theory, where behavioral theory focus on a point that a leader, or you can say an individual to become a leader, should have basic three skills. What are they? They should have technical skill, they should have human skill, they should have conceptual skill, and so on. So with this, we have completed today's lesson. I hope you liked the video.
Have you ever experienced the communication flair of someone who painted a picture in words that both inspired you and clarified how to achieve an objective? Leadership means communicating with others in such a way that they're influenced and motivated to perform actions and further common goals that lead toward desired outcomes. Communication in leadership is a process by which information and understanding are transferred between a sender and a receiver, such as between a leader and an employee, an instructor and a student, or a coach and a player. A leader can be seen as a communication champion. A communication champion is grounded in the belief that communication is essential to building trust and gaining commitment to the vision and strategy. Leaders use communication to unite people around a common sense of purpose and identify and ensure that the vision and strategy are deeply understood and accepted. A strategic conversation refers to people talking across boundaries and hierarchical levels about a group or organization's vision, critical strategic themes, and the values that help achieve desired outcomes. Leaders facilitate strategic conversations by 1. Asking questions and actively listening to others, 2. Setting the agenda for conversations by understanding key strategic themes that are linked to organizational success, and 3. Selecting the right communication channels for facilitating dialogue. Open communication means sharing all types of information throughout the organization, especially across functional and hierarchical boundaries. Open communication runs counter to the traditional flow of selective information downward from supervisors to subordinates. Good leaders want communication to flow in all directions. Communication across traditional boundaries enables leaders to hear what followers have to say, which means the organization gains the benefit of all employees' minds. Managers typically think they should be the people with the right answers. Leadership, though, is more about being the person with the right questions. Many leaders, indeed, most people in general, are unaware of the amazing power of questions. In our society, we're conditioned to come up with answers. Just as important as asking good questions is listening to the responses. Hearing is easy, but listening is hard. Listening involves the skill of grasping and interpreting a message's genuine meaning. Effective listening is engaged listening. Good leaders get out of their offices and mingle with others, ask questions, set up listening forums where people can say whatever is on their minds, and provide feedback to let people know that they've been heard. Research has attempted to explain how leaders select communication channels to enhance communication effectiveness. Studies have found that channels differ in their capacity to convey information. Channel richness is about the information that can be transmitted during a communication episode. The richness of an information channel is influenced by 3 characteristics. 1. The ability to handle multiple cues simultaneously. 2. The ability to facilitate rapid, two-way feedback. And 3. The ability to establish a personal focus for the communication. Face-to-face discussion is the richest medium because it permits direct experience, multiple information cues, and immediate feedback and a personal focus. Face-to-face discussions facilitate the assimilation of broad cues and deep emotional understanding of the situation. Communicating effectively is a critical skill for leaders. Leaders are communication champions who inspire and unite people around a common sense of purpose and identity. They lead strategic conversations that get people talking across boundaries about the vision, key strategic themes, and the values that can help the group or organization achieve desired outcomes. Persuasion is the action or fact of influencing someone or being persuaded to do or believe something. The ability to persuade others is more critical today than ever before. The command and control mindset of managers telling people what to do and how to do it is long gone. Employees don't want to know what they should do, but why they should do it. Leaders can follow 4 steps to practice the art of persuasion. Listen first. A study shows that when people feel that they've been listened to by someone trying to influence them, their liking of, trust in, and commitment to that person increases. Good leaders know that being attentive to others' needs and emotions is the first step towards influencing them. They realize that most people can't hear what you have to say until they have a chance to say what's on their minds. Leaders ask questions and listen actively and supportively build rapport, find common ground, and get a grasp on how followers may react to their ideas and proposals. In persuasion, leaders establish credibility. A leader's credibility is based on the leader's knowledge and expertise, as well as his or her relationships with others. When leaders have demonstrated that they make well-informed, sound decisions, followers have confidence in their expertise. Leaders also build credibility by listening to others, establishing good relationships, and showing them that they have their interests in mind. Persuasion is all about building goals on common ground. To be persuasive, leaders describe what they're requesting and how it will benefit others as well as the leader. Finally, in persuasion, leaders make your position compelling to others. Leaders appeal to others on an emotional level by using symbols, metaphors, and stories to express their messages rather than relying on facts and figures alone. By tapping into the imaginations of their followers, leaders can inspire people to accomplish amazing results. Persuasion is a valuable communication process that individuals can use to lead others in a shared solution or commitment. To be persuasive and act as a communication champion, leaders must communicate frequently and easily with others in their organization.